Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
So, welcome back. As we have discussed, the pharmacology of tocolytics or tocolytic agents, now we will be talking about uterotonics. From the term, it is clear, it is apparent that these will be the drugs that can stimulate the tone of the uterus, uterine tone. So, they are also otherwise called uterine stimulants, and there is another term which is also used interchangeably to refer to all uterine stimulants, it is ecbolics. So, the same group of drugs will be called uterotonics or uterine, more simply uterine stimulants or ecbolics. They are basically used for two major purposes: one, to augment or induce labor, and for prevention or treatment of postpartum hemorrhage. Postpartum hemorrhage is a condition where after childbirth there is uterine bleeding. So, as the baby is born and then the placenta is delivered, the uterus should contract, and the natural uterine contraction will prevent any kind of bleeding from the uterus. Normally, there will be very minor amount of bleeding with the childbirth, but the uterine contraction will promptly control this bleeding normally. But if for whatever reasons, particularly the most common cause of persistent bleeding following the childbirth is the bits of placenta, while the placenta is being delivered, if it is not properly delivered, then bits of placenta is left behind. As a result of that, the uterus really cannot contract properly. So, there is, because of lack of uterine contraction, there is bleeding. So, proper and appropriate placental delivery and complete placental delivery is important, but then there are other reasons also for which the mother can continue to bleed in the uterus, and there could be even profuse bleeding which can be even fatal. So, after delivery it is happening, so it is called postpartum hemorrhage. Now, physiologically, to prevent postpartum hemorrhage, the hormone that is active, that is a posterior pituitary hormone, and that is oxytocin. Oxytocin is the natural uterotonic agent, and there are also other drugs, exogenous substances, which can have properties similar to that of oxytocin. So, together all such drugs which can stimulate the uterus, particularly stimulating uterine contraction, they are called uterotonic agents. So, there are some uterotonic drugs which are actually analogs of oxytocin, synthetic oxytocin or oxytocin analogs. Besides, there are other types of drugs like ergot derivatives, ergot alkaloids, and prostaglandin analogs. They are also share the property of oxytocin, that in the sense that they also would be causing uterine contraction. So, they all these three groups of drugs, oxytocin and oxytocics, or synthetic oxytocin, oxytocin like substances, oxytocin congeners or analogs, one group. Second group is ergot alkaloids or ergot derivatives, and the third group is prostaglandin analogs, prostaglandins, some of the prostaglandins themselves and also their analogs. So, all together they will be called uterotonics. These are the three major groups of drugs. So, we have classified uterotonics as oxytocins, that means synthetic oxytocin and oxytocin analogs like carbetocin, desaminooxytocin. We have ergot derivatives, methyl ergonovin and ergometrin. Then we have prostaglandins and their analogs, particularly prostaglandin E2 and its analog dinoprostone, prostaglandin F2 alpha and its analog carboprost, and prostaglandin E1 analog, that is misoprostol. So, these are the different types of prostaglandins and their analogs that are used clinically in the management of postpartum hemorrhage. Now, coming to oxytocin. Oxytocin being a hormone, it acts via specific receptors, oxytocin receptors, that are located in uterine tissue. So, oxytocin causes receptor mediated enhancement of force and frequency of rhythmic contraction of uterus, and that happens during labor. And particularly, it is the fundus and the body of the uterus which will contract, while the lower portion of uterus, lower uterine segment and the cervix, they will remain relaxed. So, that is how it will facilitate the movement of the fetus downward, and thereby birth is facilitated, childbirth is facilitated. So, that is a physiological function of oxytocin, and when under certain clinical situations it is required to be given from outside, we administer synthetic oxytocin or oxytocin like substances which will exert similar properties as oxytocin. Now, oxytocin, really speaking, is acts as a prodrug, and its active metabolite, that is oxytocin triphosphate, it activates the sensitive calcium channels and they mobilize intracellular calcium, and this intracellular calcium availability will cause contraction of the myometrium. Now, oxytocin induced uterine contraction is at its best at term. In the early pregnancy, the sensitivity of the uterus to oxytocin is relatively less as compared to in later pregnancy or the later part of pregnancy as it approaches towards term. So, it is actually in labor where oxytocin effect is maximum. After the childbirth also, there will be some effect of oxytocin, but that is more in the breast tissue rather than in uterine tissue. Okay. So, more effect is seen in the breast tissue, but immediately after birth also the oxytocin will have its action in order to prevent the postpartum hemorrhage. That is normal physiological function of oxytocin. Besides its own stimulating property on the uterus, because of the uterine contraction and the childbirth process, there will be local tissue damage or local trauma, and this will initiate or this will facilitate prostaglandin synthesis or prostaglandin production at the local site. And this prostaglandin again has a property to centrally act on the posterior pituitary and thereby augmenting further oxytocin release, physiological oxytocin release. So, there will be more uterine contractions. The other actions of oxytocin would include, one of the major action is facilitating milk ejection acting at the breast. In fact, it will immediately after birth, when the baby will be sucking the breast, that will stimulate the milk lating, and that is actually facilitated by oxytocin. Oxytocin also causes vasodilation, it causes tachycardia. It has also, because of its structural resemblance with another posterior pituitary hormone, and that is antidiuretic hormone, or the other name for it is vasopressin. And oxytocin also has a mild antidiuretic action. Besides this, oxytocin is also believed to enhance intimacy in in human relationship and in physical relationships also. In fact, it is said that during sexual orgasm, the oxytocin has an important role to play. Coming to the different uses of oxytocin, if we try to remember in terms of its use prior to labor, its use during labor, and its use after labor. So, all uses, most of the uses are around labor, if we say. So, prior to labor, when labor is not progressing for has not started really not progressing, has not started, and pregnancy is getting continued, prolonged. So, in such a situation, for induction of labor, and that has to be done in very selected cases, slow intravenous infusion, 5 international unit in 500 milliliter of normal saline with close monitoring of uterine activity, that will help in induction of labor. So, labor pain will be initiated and then labor will progress. Then the question of labor has started, but it is not progressing. So, in such a situation also oxytocin might have a role, and oxytocin is actually used for augmentation of labor, 2 to 5 international unit of oxytocin given by slow intravenous infusion. Okay. In the same manner, same strategy, slow intravenous infusion 2 to 5 units in normal saline and closely monitored. So, continue this, labor will be progressing. After the childbirth, after labor has been completed, even after delivery of the placenta, if there is, it is found that the mother is bleeding profusely, what is called postpartum hemorrhage. In such a situation also oxytocin can be used for preventing or controlling postpartum hemorrhage. In this case, 5 units intramuscularly can be given, or if necessary, one can also give intravenous infusion slowly. We have another option to use desamino oxytocin, which is a buccal formulation, and from that buccal site oxytocin gets released and gets absorbed, and this may be also used in the same above indications alternatively. So, that is an advantage in situations at peripheral centers where intravenous administration might be logistically may not be possible. There this desamino oxytocin, which is a buccal formulation, that can, that has offered a good solution for the same indications, and they will, it will also produce similar kind of benefits. So, far as the safety issues concerned with the use of oxytocin, adverse drug reactions with faster infusion or with larger doses do happen, particularly in reference to forceful uterine contraction and sustained uterine contraction, which may lead to uterine rupture. There is also possibility of injury to the fetus because of this too much of strong contractions. Then there might be fetal asphyxia, then there is water intoxication that can be linked to its weak ADH activity or antidiuretic hormone like activity. There are some conditions where oxytocin should not be used, that is contraindications of oxytocin use, cephalopelvic disproportion, because oxytocin is being used for hastening or facilitating vaginal delivery. But if there is a disproportion between the head of the child and the pelvis, maternal pelvis is smaller in size in order to allow the fetal head to negotiate. So, that is what is called cephalopelvic disproportion, and in such a situation, if oxytocin is given, it will only cause injury to the uterus, uterine rupture, injury to the fetus, because simply because of the mechanical disproportion, mechanical block, the baby cannot be born. Besides breech presentation, oxytocin is given when there is normal presentation, normal vortex presentation or head presentation, but instead if there is presentation by the buttock of the baby, that is what is called breech presentation, in such a situation of giving oxytocin is not advisable, because that will again will cause problem, because the rotation will not happen properly. Third is about the position of the placenta. Okay, if it is in the birth canal, thereby obstructing the passage of the baby, that is what is called placenta previa. In such situation also it is oxytocin is not indicated. Besides, of course, if there is already fetal distress, oxytocin will only further augment it, and it is not advisable to start oxytocin therapy in such situations. The answer is one has to go for caesarean delivery, caesarean section. Next, we come to another group, and that is ergot derivatives. We have ergometrin, methyl ergonovin or methyl ergometrin, and we have dihydroergonovin. So, these are the three molecules that can be used for similar kind of reasons. They ergot derivatives, they cause rhythmic myometrial contractions alternating with relaxations, which is physiological, resembling the physiological uterine contractions. But the problem is it involves, unlike oxytocin, it involves fundus, body and cervical segments all together. While oxytocin, it causes upper uterine segment contraction and the lower segment and the cervix relaxation. In this case, ergot derivatives, they cause contraction of the whole uterus and also the cervix. So, that may cause a problem, create a problem. In higher doses, there is sustained contraction with no relaxation in between, and in such a situation, naturally then there might be also problems with distress to the fetus, fetal asphyxia, and also maternal injury can happen. The adverse drug reactions associated with use of ergot derivatives, starting with nausea or vomiting to headache and decrease of milk secretion in the mother, and some of the contraindications where ergot derivatives better not to be used are angina in of the mother, myocardial infarction, transient ischemic attack, history of transient ischemic attack, so, and hypertension, because ergot derivatives, they can raise blood pressure and thereby they can compromise the coronary circulation, they can compromise the microcirculation in other vital organs. So, these are the situations where it is better not to use ergot derivatives for treatment of these conditions. How they are used, ergot derivatives? There are, again, in third stage of labor, if there is uterine atony and the labor is not progressing, in order to facilitate vaginal delivery, one can think of giving 0.2 to 0.5 milligram of ergometrin intramuscular injection after the anterior shoulder is delivered. That means when the process of delivery has started, but then it is not progressing further. So, in such a situation, an intramuscular injection of ergometrin 0.2 or 2.5 milligram, that will help in smooth vaginal delivery. It is also used in prevention and treatment of postpartum hemorrhage, and same dose ergometrin intramuscular 0.2 to 0.5 milligram intramuscular for the prevention or treatment of postpartum hemorrhage after normal or after caesarean delivery can be tried. And finally, for after the childbirth, during the puerperal phase, mothers who are multipara, who has already given birth to multiple children, and these mothers, they find it difficult to get their uterine tone recovered or resumed quite quickly or quite fast. So, in such a situation, because the involution, normal involution is delayed in multipara, to hasten that, to facilitate that, one can think of using oral ergometrin at a small dose, that is 0.1 to 5 milligram 3 times a day for 7 days treatment. That can help in relatively quicker involution of the uterus. And finally, come to the third group, and that is prostaglandins and their analogs. The prostaglandin E2 and its synthetic analog dinoprostone, and prostaglandin F2 alpha and its synthetic analog carboprost, or prostaglandin E1 analog, that is misoprostol. So, they are used for similar indications, similar purposes. Misoprostol is found to be effective in both cervical ripening. Cervical ripening means cervical thinning or cervical effacement, so that the delivery, vaginal delivery is facilitated. So, misoprostol is effective in doing that, and thereby for induction of labor. In this respect, misoprostol, which is a PG prostaglandin E1 analog is actually as good as dinoprostone, which is a prostaglandin E2 analog, dinoprostone, and it is better tolerated than dinoprostone, and it is more economic than dinoprostone. So, if you compare misoprostol and dinoprostone, misoprostol is a PGE1 analog and dinoprostone is a PGE2 analog. So, E1 analog misoprostol fares superior than dinoprostone. It is equi-efficacious, but better tolerated, better safety profile, and less cost. On the other hand, if you think of the prostaglandin F2 alpha analog, that is carboprost, trimethamine, it is effective in treating the treatment resistant cases of PPIs due to uterine atony. That means, while the other measures, whether it is ergot derivatives or it is oxytocin analogs, they have been used, but they have not been able to really achieve the goal, treatment goal. In such a situation, one can think of using carboprost, and carboprost is given intramuscular injection 0.25 milligram every hour, and it causes prompt and sustained contraction. So, as soon as contractions are achieved, then its administration has to be discontinued. And we need to remember that these prostaglandin analogs should not be used simultaneously with oxytocin, because they can synergize and they can cause very strong uterine contractions, which may lead to uterine rupture. So, then we have three major groups: oxytocin and oxytocin analogs, we have ergot derivatives, and we have prostaglandins. Each has their the pros and cons, but most out of all these three, oxytocin is the primary choice for the treatment, for augmentation of labor, for induction of labor in selected cases, and also for prevention and treatment of postpartum hemorrhage. Argometrin or methyl argometrin is also a good choice, and methyl argometrin also has a oral preparation which can be used for early recovery or bringing back of uterine tone in case of multipara. That is what is called involution of the uterus. And finally, we have different prostaglandin analogs, and which can be used in resistant cases of uterine atony for delivery of the for hastening the labor, augmentation of labor. So, with this, thank you very much.